Simon & Schuster Audio presents Good in Bed by Jennifer Weiner. Read by Paula Cale.
Part 1. Good in Bed. Have you seen it? Asked Samantha. I leaned close to my computer so my editor wouldn't hear me on a personal call. Seen what? Oh, nothing. Never mind. We'll talk when you get home. Seen what? I asked again. Nothing, Samantha repeated. Samantha, you have never once called me in the middle of the day about nothing. Now come on, spill. Samantha sighed. Okay, but remember, don't shoot the messenger. Now I was getting worried. Moxie, the new issue? Cannie, you have to go get one right now. Why? What's up? Am I one of the fashion faux pas? Just go to the lobby and get it. I'll hold. This was important. Samantha was, in addition to being my best friend, also an associate at Lewis, Dommel, and Fennec. Samantha put people on hold, or had her assistant tell them she was in a meeting. Samantha herself did not hold. It's a sign of weakness, she told me. I felt a small twinge of anxiety work its way down my spine. I took the elevator to the lobby of the Philadelphia Examiner, waved at the security guard, and walked to the small newsstand where I found Moxie on the rack next to its sister publications, Cosmo and Glamour and Mademoiselle. It was hard to miss, what with the supermodel in sequins beneath headlines blaring, "Come again, multiple orgasm made easy," and "Ass-tastic, 4 butt blasters to get your rear in gear." After a quick minute of deliberation, I grabbed a small bag of chocolate M&Ms, paid the gum-chomping cashier, and went back upstairs. Samantha was still holding. Page 132, she said. I sat, eased a few M&Ms into my mouth, and flipped to page 132, which turned out to be Good in Bed, Moxie's regular mail written feature designed to help the average reader understand what her boyfriend was up to, or wasn't up to, as the case might be. At first, my eyes wouldn't make sense of the letters. Finally, they unscrambled. Loving a Larger Woman, said the headline. By Bruce Guberman. Bruce Guberman had been my boyfriend for just over 3 years, until we decided to take a break 3 months ago. And the larger woman, I could only assume, was me. You know how in scary books a character will say, "I felt my heart stop"? Well, I did. Really. Then I felt it start to pound again, in my wrists, my throat, my fingertips. The hair at the back of my neck stood up. My hands felt icy. I could hear the blood roaring in my ears as I read the first line of the article. I'll never forget the day I found out my girlfriend weighed more than I did. Samantha's voice sounded like it was coming from far, far away. Cannie? Cannie, are you there? I'll kill him, I choked. Take deep breaths, Samantha counseled. In through the nose, out through the mouth. Betsy, my editor, cast a puzzled look across the partition that separated our desks. Are you all right? She mouthed. I squeezed my eyes shut. My headset had somehow landed on the carpet. Breathe. I could hear Samantha, her voice a tinny echo from the floor. I was wheezing, gasping. I could feel chocolate and bits of candy shell on my teeth. I could see the quote that lifted in bold-faced pink letters that screamed out from the center of the page. Loving a larger woman, Bruce had written, is an act of courage in our world. I can't believe this. I can't believe he did this. I'll kill him. By now, Betsy had circled around my desk and was trying to peer over my shoulder at the magazine in my lap. I slammed the magazine closed. I took a successful deep breath and waved Betsy back to her seat. Samantha was waiting. You didn't know? Didn't know what? That he thought dating me was an act of courage? I attempted a sardonic snort. He should try being me. So you didn't know he got a job at Moxie? I flipped to the front where contributors were listed in thumbnail profiles beneath arty black and white headshots. And there was Bruce, with his shoulder-length hair blowing in what was assuredly artificial wind. He looked, I thought uncharitably, like Yanni. Good in Bed columnist Bruce Guberman joins the staff of Moxie this month. A freelance writer from New Jersey, Guberman is currently at work on his first novel. His first novel? I said. Well, shrieked, maybe. Heads turned. Over the partition, Betsy was looking worried again. That lying sack of shit! He can barely write a thank you note, I said, flipping back to page 132. I never thought of myself as a chubby chaser, I read. But when I met C, I fell for her wit, her laugh, her sparkling eyes. Her body, I decided, was something I could learn to live with. My hands were shaking, and suddenly, somehow, there were M&Ms all over the floor, crunching beneath the rollers of my chair. I gotta go, I told Samantha and hung up. I'm fine, I said to Betsy. She gave me a worried look, then retreated. It took me 3 tries to get Bruce's number right, and when his voicemail calmly informed me that he wasn't available to take my call, I lost my nerve, hung up, and called Samantha back. Good in bed, my ass, I said. I ought to call his editor. It's false advertising. I mean, did they check his references? Nobody called me. That's the anger talking, said Samantha. Ever since she started dating her yoga instructor, she's become very philosophical. Chubby chaser, I said. I could feel tears prickling behind my eyelids. How could he do this to me? Did you read the whole thing?
Just the first little bit.
Maybe you better not read anymore. It gets worse, Samantha sighed. Do you really want to know?
No. Yes, no. I waited.
Samantha waited.
Yes, tell me.
Samantha sighed again. He calls you Lewinsky-esque.
With regards to my body or my blowjobs?
I tried to laugh, but it came out as a strangled sob. And he goes on and on about your, let me find it, your amplitude.
Oh, God.
He said you were succulent, said Samantha helpfully. And zoftig, that's not a bad word, is it? God, the whole time we went out, he never said anything. You dumped him. He's mad at you, said Samantha. I didn't dump him, I cried. We were just taking a break. And he agreed that it was a good idea.
Well, what else could he do? Asked Samantha. You say, I think we need some time apart, and he either agrees with you and walks away, clinging to whatever shreds of dignity he's got left, or begs you not to leave him and looks pathetic. He chose the dignity cling.
I ran my hands through my chin-length brown hair and tried to gauge the devastation. Who else had seen this? Who else knew that C was me? Had he shown all his friends? Had my sister seen it? Had, God forbid, my mother?
I gotta go, I told Samantha again.
I set down my headset and got to my feet, surveying the Philadelphia Examiner newsroom. Dozens of mostly middle-aged, mostly white people tapping away at their computers or clustered around the television sets watching CNN. Does anybody know anything about getting a gun in this state? I inquired of the room at large.
We're working on a series, said Larry, the city editor, a small, bearded, perplexed-looking man who took everything absolutely seriously. But I think the laws are pretty lenient.
There's a 2-week waiting period, piped up one of the sports reporters. That's only if you're under 25, added an assistant features editor.
You're thinking of rental cars, said the sports guy scornfully. We'll get back to you, Cannie, said Larry. Are you in a rush?
Kind of, I sat down. Then stood back up again.
Pennsylvania has the death penalty, right? We're working on a series, Larry said without smiling.
Never mind, I said.
I sat back down and called Samantha again. You know what? I'm not gonna kill him. Death's too good for him. Whatever you want, Samantha said loyally. Come with me tonight. We'll ambush him in his parking lot. And do what? I'll figure that out between now and then, I said. I had met Bruce Guberman at a party.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.